wacky. Yeah, that was just which is pretty cute. Like, we can just like, I was 2 years ago, I was
I morning and welcome everybody. I want to welcome everybody who's out there, as they used to say in TV land, who, if you're joining us for the service online this morning, I want everyone to know that there is Sunday school for the kids today, and tomorrow, Monday, we will be having our Bible study as usual. So we'll be featuring further exploration into the way, following the footsteps of Jesus, that's been guiding us through this Lenten series. On Friday, we will be having Bible school for the kids, and we've had a couple of weeks of it already, and it has just been tremendous. Really, really wonderful. We've had 18 kids show up for each of the last Fridays that we've held the sessions, and there's been so much enthusiasm and excitement and looking forward to next week. So if you know of any young people that would like to be involved, please let them know. We're having fun here Friday evening. For those
what time is that?
What time is that? 6:30?
6 to 7:30.
Oh, 6.
Yes.
6 o'clock. Okay, 6 o'clock. For those of you who are interested in ordering flowers for Easter, there are forms at the back to be filled out. And are there any other announcements? Well then, without further ado, why don't we have Miles play for us the heart-opening song, number 150, Awesome Power.
Thank you.
start with, all the people said amen.
Others this morning? Yes.
Let's give thanks and praise for the Bible school on Friday nights during Lent.
Other people you may be thinking of, people who are especially in your heart this morning?
I had chatted with Evelyn Ahern's daughter this morning. Evelyn's home. She's doing great. She's doing great. Keep praying. She needs to build strength now. But she is able to navigate at home now. Isn't that amazing? Amazing. Amazing. Also, I wanted to share the joy of yesterday. The Massachusetts Association met in person for the first time in 2 years. And it was great. We had 54 people. We brought in 5 new churches into our state association. That's not happened in living memory. It was a barnstormer of a meeting. And worship was fantastic. It was great to be in person. And I had to share my joy. And that was just so incredible yesterday. So thanks for letting me come.
One of the churches was the Bethany Congregational Church right here in Quincy.
Yeah, so they're new.
I'm pleased to meet a woman from that church who came. Yes, wow, that was so insane.
Yeah, that's brand new for them, and they're excited to be part of the National Association as well, and they left, I think, three of the five left the United Church of Christ to join the Massachusetts Association and the National Association. So, and Bethany Union is one of those. So anyway, I just had to share my joy.
Thank you. Are there any others that you think of before we turn to a moment of silence? Thank you, dear Lord, for our gathering this morning, both here in the church and in the online community. In these next moments, we just take time to reflect on all that is near and dear to us, to the people that are in need of our thoughts. And we take a moment to ask, Lord, that you consider our needs as well. Dear Lord, we gather before you in prayer as a community of followers of Jesus. We gather together each week to learn more about how to be family with one another. And Lord, we thank you for all the strength you have given us in our own lives. There are those of us who didn't know if we would come through certain challenges, and Lord, we are here today, still in the family, still in the world, still amongst those who love us. And we ask, Lord, that you especially uplift others who are in need during this time when their own health is feeling frail, when they're confused about what might be wrong, not sure where to turn. Most especially, we ask for Val's friend Linda, who found herself in pain and unable to walk. We are glad that she has the help of doctors, but Lord, sometimes the doctors don't know what your plan is, and they can just stand by and think how to analyze the situation. So Lord, we pray that Linda's doctors gain the insight they need to be able to relieve her pain, to relieve her fears, to give her the strength that we know has been available to us, and we ask, Lord, that you bring Linda under your wing so that she may learn what it is to be strong in Christ during times of bodily weakness and struggling in spirit. We thank you for the healing that our sister Evelyn received. It was long awaited. The season of COVID made it seem like her needs were less important than what many of us feel, Lord, that still those in need are in need, in their hour of need. And finally, the medical world was able to schedule her and give her the surgery that she had awaited, and she is in the healing process. Hallelujah. Hallelujah for that. Back at home. And in our voice of hallelujah, we also give thanks for all of the fun and worship that happened with your younger children, members of this church and members of the community that came along for a Friday night of learning about Jesus, learning about the love of God, children together learning what it means to be one family in community. And that's what we are, Lord, through you. We are one family in community. And for children to grow up with this love growing in their hearts is just the most beautiful thing we could witness in our church community. We also thank you for the larger community of churches, Lord. The MACCC, the group of churches here that was unable to meet. Again, this had to do with the restrictions of COVID, Lord. But with all of that time of waiting for 2 years of not being able to meet in person, there were so many that were just chomping at the bit to be able to gather and glorify your name and learn and enjoy each other in family and feel their gifts going to good use, discovering the people around them who were in need, and being able to respond to that, Lord. And so when the group of churches gathered this time for the first time in 2 years, hallelujah, there were five more churches. Not every church had leadership in terms of a pastor assigned to oversee them, Lord. Some of the churches are struggling, but it is because of the commitment and the way your love speaks to their faith that they continue gathering. They continue listening as we listen each week, Lord, even when we are not here inside of these walls, Lord. We listen for your voice, and there are those who are still seeking pastors, and yet they gather in your name. And they were amongst those churches at the MAC gathering. For this, we sing your praises, Lord. And with happiness, with joy in our hearts, let the people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now we have a time to recognize with giving the time of our offertory. For those who prefer to give online, we have that option as well if you go to our church website.
In Venmo.
I
so we try to count them. We ask that you would receive part of what you've given us, a way in which we say thanks, a way in which we say to our lives, we belong to you, O God. And so we pray you would multiply these gifts and the blessings of our lives to be a blessing. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, our hymn of preparation today is Lord, Reign in Me.
wickedness and not follow their usual ways. So that's what this the words are about here. Now hear the word of the Lord. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but which abides forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time on and forevermore. For the scepter of wickedness shall not rest on the land allotted to righteousness, so that the righteous might not stretch out their hands to do wrong. Do good, O Lord, to those who are good, and to those who are upright in their hearts. But those who turn aside to their own crooked ways, the Lord will lead away with evildoers. Peace be upon Israel. May we come to understand these words as we grow in the love of God.
Thank you, Claire. As we turn to the New Testament today, we're going to be in Matthew's Gospel. I'll be reading from chapter 13, beginning in verse 44. Chapter 13 is sometimes called the kingdom chapter because Jesus tells several stories, several parables. A parable, that's not a word we use very often these days, but a parable is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. So you want to watch where the pieces of that fit together. And what is the point Jesus is trying to make as he reads, as he speaks? So reading from chapter 13, beginning in verse 44. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid, and then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that is thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down and put the good fish into baskets, but threw out the bad. And so it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all of this? Jesus asked. They answered, oh yes. And he said to them, therefore every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. When Jesus had finished these parables, he left that place. May God bless this reading of his word to the growing of our hearts in him. Amen.
May God guide me as I bring you some context for our scripture this morning. We're thinking about proclaiming the kingdom and the mountains. This goes together with the reading that we will be really diving into with some excitement tomorrow. The Walking in the Footsteps of Jesus by Adam Hamilton comes along with descriptions of what that part of the world was like where Jesus first, where he walked in the world and where all of his encounters took place. Now, when Hamilton asks people where they feel closest to God, can you imagine some of the answers? Where are some of the places where you feel closest to God? Anybody?
Church.
Church. Yes, that's one of the answers that would come up for him. Other places in the world where you feel close to God?
Where the mountains.
The mountains. Yes. Anywhere else that comes to mind for people? The seashore? Well, your first three answers have just hit the top three answers that Adam Hamilton gets when he asks. So, without further ado, from where we are situated by the ocean right here in Quincy, I would like to invite all of us to take a trip up into the mountains by just using our imagination, the imagination God gave us. So let's quickly visit the mountains as I recall them, about 7,500 feet up. This is from when I lived in the mountains in India. That's about 1.42 miles high, just a little under a mile and a half into the sky from here. And can anyone guess how fast we would need to travel to get that high up in just 1 minute? Any ideas how fast we have to be going?
By foot?
I don't know. We need the miracle to do it by foot. We need the miracle anyway, because I'm going to ask that we imagine ourselves traveling straight up for 1 minute, straight up at a speed of 85 miles per hour. So if you can just imagine we're going that fast, you've all gone 65 miles an hour on the highway. Do any of you have an idea how fast things are whizzing by at a speed of 85 miles an hour? People have that experience of going out. For some context, the commuter rail, top speed on the commuter rail is 79 miles per hour. So if we were to imagine we are going upward, and what we'll be able to see as we're looking down, for the next minute, we're going to imagine that you buckle your seatbelt and we're going to turn on our radio. Miles is going to give us our radio music for 1 minute going upward. Imagine ourselves going up, starting now, going up from here. We're close to the water, but we're going up really fast. It's already 85 miles a minute. Oh dear, I turned this off. walking that final road to get to the destination, what was it like? Through the cloudy mists? From the town area of close little shops and homes along the road which was traveled by local livestock, mountain goats, sheep, chickens, various cows, and the infamous Mullingar bull. The Mullingar bull was an enormous beast, the king of the road, and we all had to develop a certain amount of bravery to get past him anytime we walked back or forth from the town. Sounds of insects buzzed so loud, it was like a constant chorus drone in the background, with birdsong punctuating the atmosphere. The entire way was riddled with the appearances of rhesus monkeys of all ages, with the little ones riding atop of the older ones or clinging to the belly side and peeking out. I found out I would not need an alarm clock, thanks to the monkeys. The shy langur monkeys did not show themselves, but clattered across the metal rooftop sometime before we needed to arise. It was like a snooze alarm, how we had time to rest a while before the rhesus monkeys bounced and clattered overhead. Those little monkeys would play with our laundry when we hung it to dry, and sometimes break into our rooms to look for snacks. I once found teeth marks on a bar of wrapped soap, and I think the monkey was hoping it was a bar of chocolate. As people, we surely make our mark on the world, but up in the mountains, it is easy to feel how nature makes its mark on us. Everywhere, we were surrounded by foliage of ancient trees and seasonal flowers with a scent of freshness always in the air. We looked out over the plains, and from our lofty view, the entire world seemed like a different place. Some mountains are in drier climate, and the landmark bears different characteristics. Nonetheless, the mountains beckon many of us when we seek to feel closer to God, to be part of God's kingdom. Jesus himself spent a lot of time in the mountains. In fact, Hamilton recalls an experienced pastor who took people on tours of the Holy Land, Reverend James Ridgway Sr., who pointed out that most of the story of Jesus could be told by telling about the times he spent in the mountains. Our message from the Gospel of Matthew 13, verses 44 through 53, gives us a key theme, with Matthew describing the kingdom of heaven through several parables, this kingdom of heaven that feels closer when we're in the mountains. When you think of the word kingdom, what occurs to you? Anybody have ideas? What do you think of when you think of the word kingdom, what kingdom implies? Whether it's a place.
Community.
What's that?
A community.
Community?
Yeah.
Kingdom community. So here in the Christian church, we definitely have our Christian understanding of kingdom. And when you think of the qualities of a king, what is that like? A king. We have earthly kings, but is everybody happy under the rulership the way an earthly king rules a kingdom? No. I'm saying no. But how is it different when we speak of God as our king? Now are we talking everybody can be happy? Yes? Justice, peace, freedom from war? And where is God's kingdom located? That's the question. The Greek word, which is translated as kingdom, is basileia. The word basileia is not so much a reference to a place as it is to the idea of dominion, the quality of sovereignty, and the action of reigning. We sang that song, God, Lord, reign in me. And that's the one I always still think, Lord, reign me in. Because I get so full of that joy of kingdom feeling that God is affecting our lives. I just feel like I'll just be too much. But God's reign feels like that. Thus, the kingdom of heaven has to do with the way God is able to work in our lives when we seek guidance and follow the teachings of Jesus. The first parable tells of a person who finds treasure on a piece of land where they have no rights to that property or anything on it. In order to have access, they must raise the money to gain access to it by selling off all of what they possessed up until this point. In order to begin anew with this treasure they caught sight of in the new place. The feeling is absolute joy because what they found now is worthy of giving up everything they ever had before. This is the feeling of how the kingdom of heaven works in our lives, allowing us to feel life is rich even though we could hang on to nothing of our former life. Similarly, the merchant who spends their days in a quest for the most beautiful of pearls recognizes their dreams come true when they finally find a pearl beyond compare. It seems they do not think twice or regret a thing when they realize it will cost them everything to buy this miraculous pearl, which is like no other. Again, the kingdom of heaven gives us something better than the best of what we gathered into our life in the past. When the nets draw in the fish, only the good will be set aside. This seems like a caution to live our lives so that we will be among the righteous and not those who are cast into the fires with weeping and the gnashing of teeth. Jesus speaks of the scribe, the one who is trained in words and the way of the holy laws, who is at home in all that he knows. This is the quality of one who possesses treasure in that home of sacred learning, bringing forth the old treasure and also able to access new treasure with new understanding because of their training as a scribe of the holy word, and the holy word being the treasure. Let us be like the scribe with our ability to access God's treasures as we learn to follow the word the way Jesus taught us. Whenever we need to spend time in contemplation to remind ourselves that the kingdom of heaven is available to flow into our lives, let us seek the places in the mountains and by the sea, wherever nature allows us to hear God's voice. Our signals from God may be like the birds singing over high meadows of flowers, or like monkeys clattering across the rooftop. God may speak to us by giving us courage to get past the Mullingar bull who blocks the only path forward. But we can trust God will speak and lead us to help one another as we face the week ahead. And we must proclaim the good news to others that God is at work, most especially during these times when war afflicts the world and so many are in need. We turn to God to lead us on. Let the people say amen. Amen.
are able.
Our final hymn this morning is Lead On, O King Eternal, number 724 in the book.
Thank you. on, Liz. Priscilla, can you put up all of the light switches in the light board for us?
Where?
On the behind the glass. Can you flip up all of them?
Bonnie was watching.
Oh, good.